So today we are starting with the cis-trans test for allelism. We had in fact studied the different categories of alleles in our last class. And now we move on to a phenomena known as complementation analysis. Now, to explain complementation analysis, I have used the example of Drosophila. So now let's look into this particular case, case one. And let us see, assume that there are two mutations, MA and MB. Let us also assume that in case one, the mutations are not alleles of the same gene. So MA is a mutation for gene one, and MB is a mutation for gene two. This is one fly, and this is the second fly. And what is happening? We are crossing the two flies. And as a result of the cross of the two flies, what we will get? See, we will get, this is a normal, this is one chromosome, and this is the other chromosome. So they have produced a zygote. And when we look into this condition, see, this allele has a normal counterpart here. And this mutant allele again has a normal counterpart here. So we are getting one copy of wild type gene one in the F1 generation and a wild copy of gene two in the F1 generation. Since this wild copy will produce a normal product and this wild copy will produce a normal product, so what we observed is a wild type fly. So what is the take-home message from this cross? The take-home message from this cross is that if the mutations are not alleles of the same gene, since MA was sitting on gene one and MB was sitting on gene two. So they are not alleles of the same gene. If such mutants are crossed, we get wild type flies because there is a normal copy, wild type copy of both the mutations in the other chromosome in the F1 zygote. So that is one part of the story. Now let us look on to the other part of the story, that is case two. Let us assume that the mutations are alleles of the same gene. So gene one has one mutant allele, that is MA, and gene one has another mutant allele, that is MB. So MA and MB, both are alleles for gene one. So we do not have a wild type copy of gene one. Now, when we cross this type of fly, so we get a wild copy of gene two, but in the first fly, MA mutation was present in gene one, and in the second fly, MB mutation is present in gene one. So when they are crossed, we are seeing that the gene one is mutated either with MA or MB. Hence, we will see that the flies are not wild type. The flies are mutant flies. Now, this complementation analysis was devised by Edward B. Lewis and is used to screen the number of individual mutations that results in the same phenotype. Remember that if all the mutations fall in the same gene, they are said to be a complementation group. For example, this was a MA mutant and this is a MB mutant, right? When we crossed a MA mutant with a MB mutant, what did we get? We got a mutant fly, which indicates that MA and MB mutant belongs to the same gene one. So they are one complementation group. On the other hand, this was again a MA mutant and this was a MB mutant. When in case one, we crossed a MA mutant with a MB mutant, the result was a wild type fly. So wild type fly indicates that the two mutations are present in two different genes. And a mutant fly indicates, F1 mutant fly indicates that the two mutations in consideration are present in the same gene. That is, the two mutations are alleles of the same gene. So this was about the complementation test that was devised by Edward B. Lewis. So just remember this, if two mutants flies across and if we get a wild type product, then we have to assume that the two mutations are in two separate genes. That is the crux of cis-trans test for allelism. Now I'll be showing it to you through an example. See, we have three category of mutant with respect to Drosophila. Eye color. They are phenotypically identical. As you can see, this is the wild type eye color, and these are the eye colors observed in cinnabar, cinnabar 2, and scarlet. Now, the question is that whether cinnabar, cinnabar 2, and scarlet are present on the same gene. That is, they are mutants of the same gene, or they are present in two different genes. How do we do that? So simple, as we understood the logic, we cross the mutants. So let's see the first cross. We cross a cinnabar fly with a scarlet fly. When we cross a cinnabar fly with a scarlet fly, what we get wild type flies. Flies having wild type eye color. So it is obvious that cinnabar and scarlet mutations are in different genes. Second condition. We now cross a cinnabar 2 fly with a cinnabar. So cinnabar is once crossed with scarlet and cinnabar is then crossed with cinnabar 2. In this case also, in this case, interestingly, the product is a mutant fly. So what is the take home message? That cinnabar 2 and cinnabar mutations are alleles of the same gene. So both these mutations are present in the same gene. And finally, the third combination is we cross a cinnabar 2 with scarlet. And what we get, again a fly with wild type eye color, which indicates that cinnabar 2 and scarlet are mutations in different genes. That means of these three mutants that we started with, scarlet is in a different gene as compared to cinnabar and cinnabar 2. Cinnabar and cinnabar 2 are in the same gene. They are different mutations of the same gene. So cinnabar and cinnabar 2 falls in the same complementation group, while scarlet is in a different gene. So this is how this cis-trans test for allelism helps us to locate that whether the mutations are alleles of the same gene or whether the mutations are falling in two different genes. Now, so this was the a mutant condition we got in this cross. And now let's come to this concept that we started with the Mendelian ratios and we understood that during Mendelian ratios, during the laws that Mendelian proposed, one concept that came up was that some alleles are dominant and some alleles are recessive. Now, what is the concept behind this dominant and recessive? So this is somewhat a very modern concept, which was then not known much to Mendel. A plus is a wild type allele, which produces a functional polypeptide. Now let's look at the recessive allele. Now A is a recessive allele, which is not producing a functional polypeptide. So what we are having in case of small a, we are seeing that there is a loss of function. So most recessive mutations are therefore typically loss of function alleles. That means those alleles or those genes are not capable of producing a functional enzyme. Now, imagine if we have a genotype A plus A, this combination, where we know that A plus is dominant to A. So what will we see? We will see the wild type phenotype, because A plus is producing the wild type polypeptide, which is functional and which is capable of carrying out all the functions, even though the A is not able to produce a functional enzyme. So this was the first case. The second case is that recessive mutations can be, as you saw in this case, A, loss of function allele. A mutation can be a case where loss of function allele produces a partially functioning polypeptide. In this case, there was no functioning polypeptide. But in the second case, this is a second mutant, which is producing AH, which is producing a partially functional polypeptide. Now, when we have a combination of A plus AH, again, A plus is sufficient, or the product of A plus is sufficient to carry out the function. So in this case also, in most cases, what we see is the phenotype wild type. The difference in these two, as you can see, the difference in these two sets of mutant allele is that one allele is totally non-functional, that is, it's producing a totally non-functional enzyme, whereas the second allele is producing a partially functional polypeptide. And now, coming to the third case, AD. This is a dominant negative mutation. In dominant negative mutations, what happens? The dominant negative mutants interfere with the function of the wild type allele by producing polypeptides that inhibit, antagonize, or limit the activity of the wild type polypeptide. So this polypeptide, which is produced by the severe mutant phenotype, which is now said to be dominant one, will somewhat interfere, inhibit, or antagonize the activity of the wild type allele. So when we have a condition of A plus AD, since the AD is a mutant one, it's a dominant one, as it is interfering with the normal functional polypeptide, we are getting a mutant fly. So you can see the wild type allele was A plus, while AH and AD are the alleles for A plus. AH and AD are all mutants for A plus. AH are recessive mutants, while the AD is a dominant allele, which is interfering with the function of the normal wild type allele. So this was the concept that why some mutations are recessive and why some mutations are dominant. Now, we'll come to another concept, that is penetrance and pleiotropy, penetrance and expressivity. Let's look into this particular thing. It is a fact that a single phenotype can be influenced by many genes. But on the other hand, this is important. A single gene can influence many phenotypes. Usually what we know, that one gene is controlling one character. But in certain cases, it has been seen that there are some vital genes which are capable of influencing multiple characters. So when a gene like this one, which is capable of influencing multiple characters, is present, it is said to be a pleiotropic gene. And the multiple effects of a single gene on the phenotype of an organism is called pleiotropy. So again, once more, one gene controlling multiple characters is a pleiotropic gene, and the phenomena is known as pleiotropy. Now, what are the three, or what are the possible reasons that such a thing can happen? The possible reasons for such a thing to happen are, is that, just a second. The expression of a single gene can affect cell function in more than one way. So example, a defect in a microtubule protein can affect both cell division and cell movement. So one gene is controlling both cell division and cell movement. A single gene may be expressed in different cell types in a multicellular organism. So in variety of cells, different cell types might express that same gene. And depending on the internal microenvironment of the cell, the gene will function accordingly. And finally, a single gene may be expressed at different developmental stages. So it will be controlling different developmental phases. The best example known in humans is the PKU gene, which is the gene for phenylketonuria. The main effect of this recessive mutation, this is a recessive mutation, and the main effect for this recessive mutation is to cause accumulation of toxic substances in the brain, resulting in mental impairment. So that is the main function, to cause accumulation of toxic substances in the brain, resulting in mental impairment. However, it has been observed that when the PKU mutations occur, it also interferes with the synthesis of melanin pigment, as a result of which the color of the hair becomes light. So this gene was much studied, and when biochemical tests were done for PKU patients, it was seen that there are this certain compounds present in the blood which are absent in normal individuals. So you can understand that this single gene, whose main aim was to produce toxic substances which accumulate in the brain, on one hand, is also controlling the melanin, or is also interfering with the melanin synthesis, resulting in lightening of the hair color. And not only that, it is also responsible in producing some rare compounds in the blood, which is typical of phenylketonuria patients. So this is a beautiful example of pleiotropism found in humans. And now we move on to another concept, penetrance and expressivity. Now we'll study another example or another case, which is known as penetrance and expressivity. Now, what is penetrance? Let us imagine that when individuals do not show a trait, even though they have the appropriate genotype, it is said to exhibit incomplete penetrance. So let me define it by an example. Polydactyly is having multiple fingers, or the presence of not multiple fingers, the presence of extra fingers and toe. Now, this is a result of a dominant mutation P, which, so polydactyly results from a dominant mutation P, that is additional toe or a finger is available, but phenotypically, it is, even though there is a carrier having this P mutation, he or she might not have that extra finger or toe always. By definition, it can be defined as the percentage of individual organisms having a particular genotype that express the expected phenotype. That is the definition. Now, what does that mean? Suppose 42 individuals are having P and P combination. So genotypically they are PP. They are having the allele for polydactyly. But of the 42 individuals, it has been seen that only 38 individuals are expressing an extra finger and a toe. So phenotypically, they are manifesting the phenomena of polydactyly. 38 individuals are having an extra finger and a toe, while 4 individuals, even though they are carrier for the, even though they have the polydactyly allele, they are not expressing any abnormality. So the penetrance of the gene is 38 by 42, that is 0.9%. That means the gene is not completely penetrant. Completely penetrant gene means if there are 10 individuals, all the 10 individuals will show the same phenotype for that particular gene. But in this case, the example with which I'm explaining, that the gene is P is for polydactyly. So if it was a completely penetrant gene, then all 42 individuals should have had an extra thumb, extra finger, and an extra toe. Instead, we seeing that 38 individuals are having an extra finger or a toe, while 4 individuals are not having anything. So they're not manifesting the phenotype of polydactyly. That means the gene is not penetrating into all the individuals. So this is known as penetrance. And in contrast to penetrance, we have another similar term that is known as expressivity. So let's understand what is expressivity. Look at this picture. Now, this is a lobe eye mutation in Drosophila. You can see that this fly is not having any eye. And you can see this fly is having a beautiful lobed eye. The mutation is the same mutation, but in some, the phenotypic expression, but you can see the phenotypic expression is varying in case of the 6 flies. They are not seen. So this is the concept of expressivity, the degree to which a character is expressed. For example, in case of the extreme phenotype, as you saw, it is having tiny compound eyes. It's almost not visible. And you can see large lobed compound eyes. So the gene is unable to express itself uniformly amongst the individuals. The gene is showing the phenotype. Remember, in case of penetrance, if you remember, there were 38 individuals having an extra toe or a finger, and 4 didn't have it. But expressivity is all of them are expressing the phenotype. The degree of expressing the phenotype is varying. So that is the concept of expressivity. And now we'll move on to the final and the last part of our Mendelian genetics and its extension, that is epistasis. Remember, when we start with epistasis, the Mendelian dihybrid ratio was 9:3:3:1. The 2 alleles involved were capital R, capital R, capital Y, small r, small r, small y, small y. The 9 part was all those flies having a single dose of capital R or small y. The 1 part was all those individuals having the 2 recessive alleles in double doses. The in-between part was the presence of capital R in single or double dose and small y, or the presence of small r and capital Y in single or double doses. So when we are entering epistasis, keep this in your back of the mind. What is epistasis? The epistasis phenomena is the interaction of one gene with another gene such that one gene masks, this is important, the effect of another gene at a different locus. So there are 2 genes in 2 different locus. One gene is masking the effect of the other gene. Don't confuse it with dominance and recessive concept, because in case of dominance, the dominant gene masks the recessive gene, but both of them are present in the same locus. In case of epistasis, One gene is masking the effect of another gene, but the two genes are present in two different locus. So that is the basic difference between epistasis and dominance recessive concept. In epistasis, the gene that does the masking is called the epistatic gene. So the one which is masking is the epistatic gene, and the gene whose effect is masked is known as the hypostatic gene. So let's understand the concept by examples. We will start with the first category, that is recessive epistasis. The name itself suggests that the recessive allele is resulting in an epistatic phenomena. That is, a recessive allele is masking another gene. Understand by the name, the recessive allele is masking another gene. Now, the best example for recessive epistasis is seen in the coat color in Labrador retrievers. These dogs may have brown, black, or yellow colors, and the colors are determined, the coat colors are determined by two genes. One is the black, present in the black locus, and other is the extension locus or the E locus, okay? Now, so let's look into the example. So we are having a pure homozygous black, capital B, so you can understand the two alleles in consideration are capital B and capital E. And we have the recessive yellow, small b. And now we have the F1 heterozygote. And if you remember, once we cross this F1 heterozygotes, they are self-crossed. I mean, if we cross the F1 heterozygotes, what are the four combinations we will be getting? We will be getting the four combinations of capital B, capital E, right? Single dose or double dose. We will be getting a combination of small b, small e, right? We will get a combination of capital B, small e, and we will get a combination of small b, capital E, one dose or two dose. Now, in this particular recessive epistasis, the small e allele combination will mask the effect of the other gene. So we are having two such genotypes where the recessive small e combination is present. So this recessive small e combination will mask the effect of small b and will mask the effect of capital B. So small e combination is epistatic to either capital B or small e, as capital B or small b. In either case, we will be getting yellow coat colors. So the Mendelian ratio changes. If you remember, as per the Mendelian ratio, this is 9, this is 3, this is 3, this is 1. Now this 9 is fine, this 3 is also fine, but we are having similar phenotype for the in-between ones. So the ratio becomes 9 is to 3 is to 4. So this phenotypically, these two ratios combine. Let's look into the diagram. So that is what I now explained you just now, that small e, the genotype small e, at the second locus marks the expression of the black and the brown alleles at the first locus. So this is how recessive epistasis works. So the second locus is the dominant allele E. Now, the dominant allele E allows dark pigment to be deposited, while the recessive allele E prevents deposition of dark pigment, causing the hair to be yellow. So wherever there is small e present, we are having yellow hair color. wherever there is capital B present, that is black, and wherever there is capital E present, that is brown hair color. So this is how the three hair colors occur. So this was the first change in our ratio. This is recessive epistasis, as I was talking about. One locus determines the skin cells, the dominant B encloses black, whereas the recessive B encloses the brown pigment. And the allele at the second locus affects the deposition of the pigment in the shaft. And as I said, as we saw in this case, the recessive combination, small e prevents the deposition of the dark pigment. So in absence of the two dark pigments, brown or black, the hair color is yellow. When small e combination is present, it masks the effect of capital B and small b, as a result of which we are getting yellow hair color. And the changed Mendelian ratio, the Mendelian dihybrid ratio is 9:3:3:1. In this case, we are getting the changed Mendelian ratio, which is 9:3:4. We'll now study another example, which you did earlier when we studied multiple alleles. And if you remember, this is recapitulation of what we had done. In the blood group, I told you that there is an eight substance. And to this eight substance, fucose is added. That is eight substance precursor. So this is the eight substance. To the H substance, from the ABO locus, there is this ABO locus and there is this H locus. From the H locus, the function of the H locus is to produce the H substance. And once the H substance is produced, in the ABO locus, we can have the IA allele or the IB allele. The IA allele will produce glycosyl transferase, which will add N-acetyl galactosamine to the H substance, or the IB allele, it will produce a glycosyl transferase, which will add galactose to the H substance. So we have to have this H substance present for IA allele or IB allele to become functional. In absence of the H substance, even though there might be an IA allele or IB allele, no functional A or B antigen will be produced. So let's understand this concept from this picture. So this is the H locus. There are two locus, and this is the ABO locus. The ABO locus, we know there are three categories. IA is one allele, IB is another allele, and small I, which does not produce any glycosyl transferase. The H locus has a recessive H allele, a dominant capital H allele, or it can have a recessive condition, small h, small h. When it has a dominant condition, that is capital H is present in single or double dose, the H substance is produced. Only when the H substance is produced, the ABO locus can now function and produce these three categories of blood groups, A antigen, B antigen, or O antigen. But if we are having a recessive mutant condition in the H locus, where both small h alleles are present, no functional enzyme is produced, as we understood from the concept of dominant and recessive. Remember that when there is a recessive allele, if you remember, there was no functional enzyme. So if there is no functional enzyme, no functional product, no H substance. So in this particular condition, we are having a functional ABO locus, but a non-functional H locus, no H substance is produced. So in spite of having a functional ABO locus, since there is small h in the H locus and no H substance is produced, no terminal sugars can be added. And hence we are getting a precursor H substance present in these individuals. So even though they may have an IA allele or an IB allele in their ABO locus, these individuals will show a O phenotype. So this is basically the Bombay phenotype, where that I had talked about during my multiple allele class. So now let's look into this. So this is the age. So it's O blood, O type of people, and there is no A and B antigen produced, even though the individuals may have a IA or a IB allele. So you can see when we are having a small age condition, it is masking the effect of the ABO locus. It is totally masking the ABO locus. So whenever we are having a small age condition, we are having, there is no H compound, no A antigen, B antigen, and so the blood is always O category. So the ABO locus, in this case, the HH allele is epistatic to the ABO locus, or the ABO locus is hypostatic to the HH allele. Now coming to dominant epistasis. From recessive epistasis, you've understood one fact, that any one of the recessive alleles, when present in homozygous setup, is masking the effect of a dominant allele. In case of dominant epistasis, a single dose of a dominant allele is enough to mask the effect of the other allele. So in this particular condition, let us start with this one. We have to start that allele W will mask the effect of capital Y and small y. Now let us understand the mechanism of how this is done. This is a plant, as you can see. Now, this plant is producing a white color. It has an intermediate green color and it has a yellow color. Now let us look into the molecular mechanism. When there is a WW condition, small WW, enzyme 1 is produced. And when there is a capital Y condition, single dose or double dose, enzyme 2 is produced. The enzyme 1 converts compound A to compound B, as a result of which it becomes green in color. And the enzyme 2 converts compound B to compound C, as a result of which you can see the fruit color of summer squash is becoming yellow. So there are three fruit colors of the summer squash: white, green, and yellow. We again once more, the green color is obtained when WW plants produce enzyme 1, which converts compound A to compound B. And the yellow color is obtained when Y, capital Y bearing plants produce enzyme 2, which converts the green color compound B to the yellow color compound C. So this is a normal phenomenon. So to get a C flower, we have to have this particular combination. That is the final product. Now we started with the fact that the allele W is epistatic to capital Y and small y. Now how is that? All the combinations having a W, capital W. So these are capital W combinations. They will mask the effect of this allele. How it is possible? Because in the picture you see, enzyme 1 is produced only by plants having WW. Plants which are having a capital W is inhibiting the production of the enzyme. So you can see capital W is inhibiting the production of the enzyme. So if there is no enzyme one produced, no compound B, no compound C, all flowers will be white in color. So whenever we are having a combination of this or a combination of this, all flowers will be white in color. So let's look into the combination. So as I was saying, you, whenever we have a, whenever capital W is present, either in one dose or double dose, it is masking the effect of the Y allele. So as you can see, because enzyme one is not being produced, so we are having white squash. That is 9 plus 3 plants, that is 12, the ratio has changed. 12 plants will be showing you white squash. Whenever we have a WW combination, which is producing compound B, as a result of WW, compound B is produced, and we have a capital Y, compound B is converted to compound C, we are having yellow squash, that is 3. And again, we are having a WW combination, so compound A is converted to compound B by WW. And you see the YY plants are again inhibiting the production of enzyme 2. So these plants get stuck in this condition and they give the green squash. So the change ratio is 12:3:1. So this is an example of dominant epistasis, where one dominant allele is being epistatic to the other set of allele. It suppresses the expression of the other set of allele. So that was the F2 generation. The ratio has changed, the black box, 12:3:1. Here, W allele is a dominant allele. And in the previous cases, what we saw, there were two recessive alleles that act as the epistatic allele. In case of Labrador, it was the small a, small a combination. And in case of Bombay phenotype, it was the small h combination. Now coming to duplicate recessive alleles. When we are talking about two genes, we are having two sets of recessive alleles. Remember that. We are talking about two genes. So we are having two sets of recessive alleles. And one recessive allele is epistatic to the other allele. What does that mean? Let's study it by an example. See, now let's first understand the phenomena. Snails with capital A and snails with capital B. So the two genes in consideration are A and B, right? So all those snails having a single dose of capital A or a double dose of capital A will produce enzyme 1. The enzyme 1 converts compound A to compound B. All those snails having a single dose of capital B or a double dose of capital B will convert compound B to compound C. That means capital A, capital A, and capital B, capital B, or capital A, capital B, small b. All these combinations will produce the compound C because they have a single or a double dose of capital A and B. Now, what are the other conditions that can be obtained? The other condition is that capital A, small a, capital B, small b, small a, capital B, capital B. Okay, this is one condition. And the second set of condition that we can obtain from such a cross is that, this is the third condition. This is the separate condition. This is with respect to the other allele, one condition. And with the respect to the another allele, so, look into these two conditions. Duplicate recessive epistasis means when small a is present in together, they will mask the effect of the B allele. Again, when small b are present together, they will mask the effect of A allele. So that is duplicate recessive epistasis. So if small a is present in a combination, it is masking the effect of the B allele. If small b is present in the combination, it is masking the effect of the A allele. Let's see the cross. Now, let us first understand. So we understood what the capital A and the B allele does. The capital A converts compound A to compound B, and the B allele converts compound B to compound C. So when we have a snail containing only compound A, it's albino. Same snail containing compound B is also albino. Compound C are the brown snails. Okay. As I said, when we are having a combination of small a, enzyme 1 production is inhibited. So you can understand, no compound B, no compound C. So all the snails are white. Similarly, again, when we are having a combination of small b, no enzyme 2. So all the snails get stuck here in the intermediate albino stage. We do not get brown snails. So if we have a small a combination, the snails are stuck here with compound A condition. If we have a condition where there is small b snails, the snails are stuck in the compound B combination. So this is a pigmented category. Capital A, small b. So this is one recessive set present albino. Another recessive set present albino. Another recessive set present albino. So the modified ratio becomes 9:7. So this is duplicate recessive epistasis. So that was what was explained. And now we move on. So this was example one. I can show you another example of duplicate recessive epistasis. This is related to a flower color. See, the end product of the flower, the end color is a purple color. Now let's start. We have a precursor white, we have an intermediate white, and we have a purple colored product. Single or double dose of C gene produces an enzyme that converts precursor white to intermediate white. Single or double dose of capital P gene converts intermediate white to purple end product. So if C and P are present in single or double doses, we're getting the purple end product. In any other condition, you have a small c or a small p. So when we have a small c, this portion is inhibited, so we get a precursor white only. If we have a combination of small p, this transition is inhibited, so we have an intermediate white. So go to the cross. So small c is epistatic to capital P and small p, and small p is epistatic to capital C and small c. Now let us look at the colors. So you can understand that we are having a small p combination, a small c combination, and a small p combination. All these three flowers are white. So that is another example of duplicate recessive epistasis. That is 9:7. And finally, we come to the last category of epistasis. That is the duplicate dominant epistasis. Imagine capital A and small a. So A and B are two alleles. Now, what are the combinations obtained in such cases? We have a combination like this. Sorry. In when we are considering two alleles, what are the 9:6:6:1 ratio? This is 1, this is 9. Okay, let's. This is 3. This is 3. this is one. This is our Mendelian dihybrid ratio. So when we are considering dominant duplicate epistasis, we have to understand that capital A will mask the effect of capital B or small b, and capital B will mask the effect of small a. In these cases, all these conditions will give rise to a single phenotype. So the 9:3:3:1 ratio becomes modified to 15:1. Because capital A is masking the effect of capital B, and capital A is masking the effect of capital B or small b, and capital B is capable of masking the effect of small a. So all of these three conditions will give rise to a same phenotype, resulting in the change ratio to 15:1. Since we do not have any capital A or capital B in this condition, so we get a different phenotype for this condition. So this is dominant duplicate epistasis, as I was saying you. And the heart shape F1 fruits are closed, and we see that the F2 show ratio of 15 heart-shaped fruits and one narrow fruit. As I told you, that capital A is epistatic to capital B and small b, and capital B is epistatic to capital A and small a. And thus, the 15:1 ratio, when these types of process are done, so this 15:1 ratio show heart-shaped fruit, and that one part is the narrow fruit. So here, duplicate genes involved in the fruit shape phenotype, and the dominant allele in this condition is epistatic to either allele of the other gene. So this is an extreme condition of epistasis, and these are thus the different combinations of epistasis we studied today. As you can see, we started with the 9:3:3:1 ratio. When we are having a recessive epistasis, in this case, small a is masking the effect of capital B or small b. That is recessive epistasis. Now, that was a change ratio, 9:3:4. Now we have another change ratio, that is 12:3:1, which is dominant epistasis. Here, capital A is masking the effect of capital B and small b. So the change ratio is 12:3:1. So that is dominant epistasis. Then we studied duplicate recessive epistasis. In case of duplicate recessive epistasis, as you can see, capital B, small b is masking the effect of capital A. Small a is masking the effect of capital B. And small b are present. So all of them will give the same phenotype. So the change ratio is 9:7. Another interesting thing we studied finally was the duplicate dominant epistasis. In duplicate dominant epistasis, as you can see, capital A is masking B, capital B and small b, or capital B is masking capital A and small a, as a result of which the ratio is changed to give rise to 15:1. So that is duplicate dominant epistasis. And now, before ending, just last part of the talk, that is sex-limited and sex-influenced inheritance, because we get confused with these two terms. Now, in case of sex-limited, the diagram that has been shown here is that of sex-influenced. In case of sex-limited, the difference in the phenotype of the two sexes are related to different complements of genes on the sex chromosome. And sometimes there are genes on the autosomes that are present in particular one phenotype and absent from the other phenotype. Let me give you some example of sex-limited trait. Some example of sex-limited trait is the milk production dairy cattle. Females can produce milk. The genes are present in both males and females, but the genes are operative in females and silenced in males. Distribution of facial hair in humans. In case of males, the facial hair is extremely expressed, but in case of females, the facial hair is not expressed. So this is sex limited. The sex is limiting expression of certain genes. Now there is another concept, that is sex influenced. In case of sex influenced, one very important and classical example is the pattern baldness. So if you look into this particular cross, you are having a non-bald female and a bald male. The bald male is BB, which is a recessive gene, and the wild type lady is B plus, B plus. And then we are having this haploid gametes, and then this cross is taking place. So you can see the F1. In the F1, they are heterozygous, B plus B. But look at the phenotypic expression. If the heterozygous is a male, then it is bald. If the heterozygous is a female, you can see that she is non-bald. It indicates that this trait is to some extent is dominant in males. So it is acting as a dominant fashion in males and in a recessive fashion to some extent in females. So this is sex influence. In males, the expression of the B allele is influenced by the sex hormone testosterone. So testosterone is responsible for expression of the pattern baldness allele. So that is why this is known as sex influence, because testosterone is a male sex hormone. So that hormone influences the expression of the bald pattern. Now, we are starting the cross with a heterozygous female and a heterozygous male. We are starting the cross with a heterozygous female and a heterozygous male for the bald allele. And now you can see that we are getting four conditions, a wild type condition, two heterozygous condition, and then we are getting a homozygous condition. In the wild type condition, no issues. In the heterozygous condition, as I showed you the difference in male, the males will become bald, but the females will be heterozygous but non-bald. But when it is in homozygous condition, as you can see, the female is affected. So in this condition, the female will become bald. So in the heterozygous condition only, we can understand how this particular bald allele is sex influenced. And I told you the reason for expression of baldness in case of males, the male hormone testosterone. So this was a concept of sex influenced and sex limited trait. And with that, we come to the end of our class. So we did all this in our class. And this is also the end of your third topic.